Aloha and hello out there, everybody. What's going on? This is Miho with the Too Close to Call podcast series, and I am joined today by a very special guest and a soon-to-be reoccurring guest. Based on your feedback from last week down in South Carolina, people want to hear a little bit more from this man, and we brought him on, and we've decided to do a once-a-week Pit Panther podcast. And for those of you who know me listening already, you know now who my guest is, but for those of you who don't, I'd like to welcome on my father, Chris Mahalik, who actually has University of Pittsburgh ties himself.
Well, thank you, Miho. I'm really excited about being here and being part of this new weekly podcast show. Kind of give you a little bit of background. I'm a Pitt graduate, long time ago, albeit, but a Pitt graduate nonetheless, and a long time Pitt football fan slash sufferer. But you could call me a Pitt diehard, no doubt about it. For those also listening, my daughter played softball at Pitt, and my son-in-law played soccer at Pitt. So, you know, strong Pitt connection here. And, you know, as far as you're concerned, you know, being raised in my family, you actually had no choice. You were going to be a Pitt fan.
Yeah, right. Well, apparently I'm the black sheep because I decided to go to Lehigh University and not Pitt there with rattling them off. But
honestly, you could not get into Pitt.
Well, that's true. That's true. Lehigh made an exception for me there based on looks, I think it was. It had nothing to do with grades.
Exactly.
It was purely looks. Exactly. But yeah, like I said, and my old man just mentioned, diehard Pitt fans here in this house, watch every game we can. That's been a little bit of a challenge this year, and I guess we'll jump right into that. Dude, the ACC network, man.
Not happy. Not happy here in Eastern Pennsylvania. And for those listening, this is going to have a little bit of an Eastern PA flavor.
I like it.
Let me add that Kevin and I are not Yinzers.
Yes, that's right.
Exactly.
We drink soda.
Exactly.
Not pop.
Exactly.
You guys
wear sneakers and not tennis shoes.
Oh, my God. Tennis shoes. You don't play tennis. You don't wear tennis shoes.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
Unbelievable,
right.
Unbelievable out there with these guys. Although yeah. I will give them. I do like Permane Brothers.
Yeah, that is good. That is good.
I'll take that with the cheesesteak.
Absolutely right.
But,
absolutely right.
Yeah, so the ACC Network here in Allentown, you guys have a little bit more of a local provider, but myself, being in Greater Philadelphia, even Comcast Xfinity not carrying the ACC Network. We can't be the only ones pissed about this.
There has to be. There has to be. And may I add, there are a fair amount of Pitt people in Eastern PA.
Not even Pitt people, all of ACC.
Well, that's
man.
True, too. Like, you have Syracuse, Boston College, right? Absolutely.
Clemson.
Right.
There's people in Carolina that got to be pissed off.
Absolutely.
Here. And that's where I was saying locally, I get it, maybe with the smaller provider, but Comcast, you got some tweets coming here, I'll tell you what.
Well, yeah, and also my local cable provider, Service Electric.
Yeah.
I've called in, emailed numerous times, and to no response.
Yeah, you know, it's wild.
I said, basically, you know, we have the Big Ten network, and of course, everyone knows why we have the Big Ten network here.
Yeah,
in
that's
PA.
Right.
I mean, someone's got to watch the dairy school in central Pennsylvania. But
that's right.
But I'm hoping that they would have enough common sense to put the ACC network on, you know, especially when come wintertime, you look at basketball.
Sure.
Who's not going to want to watch Duke, you know, North Carolina and Syracuse in basketball,
sure.
Right?
Yeah, so, the national ESPN can only carry one of those games
exactly.
If they're, you know, playing on the same day. So, obviously, with that being said, we caught a little bit of a condensed version of the game, having it been, you know, radio, YouTube highlights, all of the above. But we've seen, read, and heard what we need to in order to take opinions based on week one. And obviously, it was a huge week. The ACC opener, Coastal Division. Virginia's favored to win the division. Pitt won it last year. So this could almost have been a Coastal Division championship match, so to speak. And a 30-14 loss right off the bat. Just initial reactions, thoughts, comments, concerns. What do we got, man?
Ugh.
See, that's UGH for all you guys scoring at home out there.
Yeah, anticipation was high for this. You know, I know I was looking forward to this game because you know certainly would have been an early barometer for maybe what is to come. But watching the highlights, Pitt played. You know, they came back in the second quarter and had a solid second quarter, took the halftime lead. And for them to perform the way they did, you know, in the second half was just, you know, extremely disappointing and honestly, inexcusable in that type of scenario. But, you know, if you look at it, you know, if you look at the three aspects of football, you know, let's look at the offense to begin with.
Okay.
Offensive line, questionable at best. Morrissey and Hargrove had excellent grades. The rest of the offensive line did not. But it is a new line. It's going to take some time. You know, Virginia seemed to do a lot of blitzing, which I would have done as well.
Sure.
You know, to test out the new line. And, of course, you know, the play of Kenny Pickett, everyone's talked about it.
It took me six plays.
No.
To write off Kenny Pickett.
No, I think it took you about four plays.
Four plays? Okay. Write off Kenny. Pass plays, six total plays. Oh, my God.
Needless to say, Mijo was extremely upset. I mean, Kenny Pickett was showing happy feet.
Oh, God.
Running into the pass rush. I mean, unfortunately, pretty much the stuff we saw last week.
And that's the problem was he's got
last year.
Yeah, he's got a year of starting experience. He went to the Peyton Manning camp during the offseason. Apparently, he's going to develop. He's moving forward. And all of that is great, except for it's all 7-on-7. It's all against, air out there. And when you get the big uglies coming at you, and I don't know with him if it's the fact that the offensive line is questionable. So every time he's ever played, he's been under duress. But you can tell he does not trust anybody whatsoever, because you mentioned it. There were twice where a blitzer would come and the running back would pick it up. Well, he didn't trust him to do so and kind of ran right into the blitzer there. And then there were other times where nobody was around him and he was just kind of floating around backwards, backwards, backwards. And then all of a sudden you throw off your back foot and that's how you miss guys high. That's how you're out of bounds. That's how you're not on time. And it was just extremely frustrating because, like you mentioned, it was shit we had seen before. It was right. Correctable right. Coaching, opportunities. And I guess Mark Whipple, now they have game film to go off of because it's tough to recreate situations like this in practice. But just for a first initial test grade on being like, hey, where are we at? Oh, it was not good.
No, it certainly wasn't, Kevin. And like you said, it was more the same from last year. It was disappointing. I mean, to Kenny Pickett's defense, when you go into last year, I mean, and there was one play earlier in this, I think it was the first quarter, second quarter, he took a deep drop, rolled to his left. By the time he was even rolling to his left, there were two guys in his face. We saw that numerous times last year. That's why I'm giving Kenny Pickett a little bit of a pass here, because he's been seeing this now for like 12, 13, 14 games. But there has to come a point where there's improvement. Okay,
so I think it's this next week against a inferior Ohio team because, yeah, I get it. Virginia, right off the bat, good squad. Like I said, supposed to win the Coastal. So talented individuals there. But when you're going against Ohio, if I start seeing happy feet and him floating when people really aren't that close to him, it's like, come on, man, it's not going to get any easier than this. Conference play, the talent's going to be higher than this. So if you're not going to step in there against an Ohio program, there's nothing to say you're going to do it. So it's, you got it on film now. You see what works. You got to move forward. Kenny Pickett needs to take a huge step from weeks 1 to 2.
As does the entire offense. And they say the most improvement is from week 1 to 2. So we'll see if that is indeed a true case here. So,
what was your thought overall on the game plan? Obviously, we saw a ton more passes. No longer Pat Narduzzi, right.
You mean like the first six plays?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying, right?
And Pat Narduzzi's.
We talked
about this when we there, and there were three and outs, by the way, three and outs. So
yeah.
You mentioned to me as we were watching the game, you can only imagine Narduzzi going up to Whipple and saying, run the effing ball,
right?
So
I mean, if you look at the box score, I think it was like 15 or 17 carries combined between Davis and Sibley, and it's frustrating because they did get behind early and then they put those two long drives together right before halftime. So you thought you saw a little bit of a rhythm there. But if you see a quarterback who's struggling with protection, maybe has a little bit of happy feet, you would think that coming out in the second half, trying to establish the run and maybe giving those linebackers a little bit of pause in the play action game, maybe making them, drop back instead of crashing down on the quarterback every time. And with 15 carries, you're not establishing any sort of identity with the run.
No, that's correct. And I look for them to do that a little bit more this week. I look for them to be a little bit more balanced this week. And they have to be. They have to be. They have to work out a few things because they got, after Ohio, they got two big games at Penn State, and then UCF comes to town. So you got two ranked teams coming. So, yeah, this is the week you want to figure some things out.
Yeah, because those next two ain't the time here.
Exactly.
Ain't the time. But we'll transition into the defense here, and there's good news, bad news on that side of the ball. So which way do you want to go first there?
Well, let's talk about the bad news. I mean, the loss of Kashawn Kemp is just devastating. I mean, so this is, you know, him with Rashad Reaver, that's two defensive line starters that they've lost after week one. Or before week one.
Probably their top two.
Exactly.
Or
exactly
arguably right. After his performance through, I think it was like 20 snaps or something like that until he banged up his knee.
He was playing a heck of a football game. He really was. He had tackles. He had pressures. He was a force. And sure, you know, every coach speaks as a, you know, hey, next man up.
Sure.
Right. And they have no choice but to do it. But yeah, you take any team in the country and lose two of their top four defensive players on the line, it's going to hurt them. But saying that, the defense played what I thought was a pretty strong game.
Yeah, I agree with that. Obviously, you look at the scoreboard and you don't think so.
Right.
But you dive into some detail there, and it really was. I mean, Virginia's three scoring drives, a couple of them after turnovers, and I think one after a blocked punt, but they were all less than 30 yards.
Exactly.
Yep. I mean, yes, you would like your defense to, you know, step up, pick up the offense, maybe hold them to a field goal. One, two of those three times. So there is that little bit of aspect of, listen, if they screw up, you're going to have to pick them up. It's going to happen this year. It's going to happen again in the Penn State game. It's going to happen in the UCF game. And you're not going to be allowed to give up 6 points every time if you want to win the football game. But they didn't allow Virginia to put together 10, 12, 15 play drives. And if Pickett evolves and becomes maybe a little bit more of a game manager and they find that niche with Whipple trying to make plays, but also realize that the strength of this team maybe on the defensive side,
right,
play a little bit more of a ball control, field possession, don't turn the ball over type of game. Because I got news for you, man. I don't think you're going to out-athlete or out-speed or out-space Penn State, UCF, or a lot of these teams in the conference.
No question. It comes down to scheme at that point.
Yeah. Yes. So you're going to have to make the adjustments. And defensively, watching the highlights, I thought Pitt blitzed more than in years past. I think he wants to do because he enjoys playing man coverage.
Well, I think for the first time, Narduzzi's got defensive backs that he's comfortable with.
That he trusts back
big,
there.
Big, fast, corners, strong safeties that will come out and smack you in the mouth. And that gives him, obviously that gives him a little bit more leeway to blitz.
Yeah, sure. And that was kind of the good news, was the play of a few individuals on the back end and kind of, a few defensive heads stood out too. But the guy who jumped off the page in my mind was Paris Ford.
Agreed.
And I know he's kind of got the recruiting aura that comes with him. And this is what, year three, two?
Yes.
Three. And he's finally on the field here as a four-star guy. We thought he'd be on the field 3 months after he stepped on campus, and it's a little bit later. But it took, I think, one or two drives where he made a play. He ran down Virginia's quarterback, who was going for the pylon from basically the center field position at his safety, and tripped him up just short. And I remember looking at you going, Pitt doesn't have guys that make those plays.
They haven't in a long time.
Right, like,
they haven't in a long time.
You know, even Whitehead was athletic, and, you know, you got Hamlin who can play, but this kid, it was just boom, and there it was. There was a tackle, and I was like, holy shit, where'd he come from?
Well, I believe you said that was a 4 or 5-star play that kid made.
Really,
and we haven't seen that at Pitt for a long time.
Yeah, I thought he was, I'm going, shit, and then I'm like, we got him, jeez.
Exactly, he came out of nowhere. He really did. He had some serious closing speed, and then he stripped the guy, the wide receiver, causing a fumble.
Absolutely.
You know, that was the only thing that the Pitt defense could try to do more of, and is try to get some turnovers. I don't think they had 8 turnovers in this game. But I look for that to improve as well. But no, Paris Ford was definitely a bright spot on the defense. Absolutely.
Yeah, the last thing I liked about him is his attitude and swagger. Because you saw a play where I think Pitt sends some people and the guy was wide open and the Virginia guy just kind of lofted it up and ended up being like a 35, 40-yard play. Paris Ford came over, helped with the tackle, pushed him out of bounds. But he got up furious.
Yes, he did.
At his guys. And just the accountability side of football in that aspect, it made me feel like I was watching Malcolm Jenkins play the game.
Great point.
You know what I'm saying? Where it's like, I know what I'm supposed to do. You need to know what you're supposed to do. And if you don't, it's unacceptable. And I don't care if everybody sees it, but I'm going to let you know right now.
Agreed. Absolutely.
And there's just none of that on the offensive side. And it makes sense, because if you were going to ask me who it would be on the offensive side, can't come up with anybody. it's got to be Pickett, but it's not because of the way he's played.
Exactly.
And he doesn't have
he doesn't have that it factor with the offensive team right now.
Right. And so
because
it's like
if he gets in the huddle and starts yelling at people, you can almost see like some offensive lineman go, "Who the hell are you to be telling us what to do here?"
Right.
And he's got to earn that respect, and he hasn't done it yet.
And that's tough, and they don't have that bell cow back. And the only fifth-year guy is I believe Tipton on the outside is a fifth-year guy. So he could kind of be the only one who gets in there and goes, "Listen, dudes, I'm done. Like, this is it." You know what I mean? So I just like that aspect of kind of that Narduzzi fire, and the defense can feed off of somebody with that type of energy and who backs it with, like you just said, the ability to make plays.
Yes. I mean, the only other guy I could see on the offensive line doing that would be Morrissey, the center.
I agree with you, actually. Yep. He's probably the guy after he played last year. And like you said, reading, it seemed that he graded out well on, you know, your Pro Football Focuses and other websites that do that type of stuff. So it may be a week or two, but if he, you know, if he's making calls and people aren't doing the right things, I certainly look for him to get in somebody's face.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, and the third aspect we have to look at last week's game, of course, is special teams.
Yeah. Block punt.
Block punt. I mean, you know, it's funny because the first time he punted, you know, I thought to myself, boy, he took a long time getting rid of that ball.
Yeah, that guy was close.
And then sure enough, the second time it's blocked. And then it was, you know, after that, his releases were much quicker.
Yeah.
You know, so that, you know, that caused him dearly. Now, you know, I'm, you know, missing a 55-yard field goal, I'm not going to criticize anybody. But
yeah, 55, whatever it was. Either way, it wasn't a gimme.
You know, it wasn't a chip shot. No. You know, but, you know, those are, you know, these types of games would be nice to make those, obviously. But, you know, that was a time span in there when we were watching that game where, you know, missed block punt, missed field goal, you know, turnover. That was the ball game right there.
Yeah, coming out of halftime, it was, I believe, Virginia kicked a field goal, and then on the next possession on third down, Pickett threw an interception, which gave Virginia the short field again, who punched it in, and all of a sudden you went from up one to down nine. And again, you don't kind of have any sort of true identity that you found. There's no bread and butter. Let's calm down. We're going to run to the left twice. It's going to be third and three, and then we got to make a play. It's okay, now what? Where are we going? What are we doing? And that takes time with new coaching and new offense
new
and new development.
Yep, but, absolutely.
You know, that's something they're going to have to figure out sooner than later. And we briefly touched on it. We'll just kind of wrap up this edition with really Pitt's only hopefully scrimmage here, or at least it read on the schedule. But as game time is coming closer and closer, the Pitt Panthers under a touchdown favorite. I don't know exactly where it is. I think I saw it 6.5, 6. It's floating around.
I think it's 5.5 right
now. Down to 5.5. So that sounds like people aren't jumping on that Pitt bandwagon here based on the performance.
Well, this quote-unquote scrimmage that Miho's referring to are the Ohio...
Supposed to be!
The Ohio Bobcats. This is anything from a scrimmage. I mean, Ohio, I believe they won 8 or 9 games last year. They have a lot of people coming back. They have a lot of fifth-year seniors on their offensive line. And this is a team that's favored to win the MAC.
You know, okay, I don't think I knew that.
Yeah, so, I mean, so what concerns me is that, you know, this is obviously going to be a letdown game for Pitt. Okay, as a longtime season ticket holder.
You would think not anymore, but.
Correct, but as a longtime season ticket holder, I can tell you what the environment, the game day atmosphere is going to be like at Heinz Field at 11 a.m.
Yeah, what's the deal with that? Do you know why that is?
ACC Network, TV, baby.
Because of what's on at 12.
I'm not sure what's on at
2
12,
o'clock instead
exactly.
of 3 o'clock?
It's because of the ACC Network.
I don't know. I don't get that. Yep. I don't.
There's this push now by some of these teams to play earlier games. I know the Pac 12 is looking at some 9 a.m. kickoffs to get more TV exposure on the East Coast and so forth.
But you know, as a guy who would like to see Mike Trout play more baseball,
let's get him
going. I don't know about Stanford, USC answering the bell that early here, but I don't know. Yeah, I'm 100%, man. 11 o'clock. Kids got a bus down to the...
You had a fairly decent crowd last week, around 40,000, 45,000, whatever
it was. It was a good ACC crowd.
It was a good ACC crowd for Pitt, absolutely. And then, you know, this week, you're going to have 25,000, 30,000 people there, that 11 a.m. kickoff.
Yeah.
So, I mean, but to your point, they lost last week. Pitt's got to overcome that. And I think they will. I think they will. But it's something that I think the coaching staff will need to address.
How are you feeling overall going in the game? Do you think it's a couple of touchdowns? You see a competitive football game? I mean, just, you know, kind of what are you thinking here? Because I'm looking into some Ohio, you know, Bobcat stats here, and my man Nathan Rourke,
yes,
quarterback, had a heck of a football game actually last week against Rhode Island. 16 of 22, almost 200 yards, 2 scores, no picks. Oh, and look at that. your leading rusher as well. 10 carries, 75 yards, and a touchdown. And did we just see a quarterback kind of run around and make some plays not too recently against the Pitt Panthers?
Yeah, I think that was last Saturday.
Oh, that's right. So what? No, that's right. Hence the 6.5 to 5.5 coming here.
But actually, you know, but actually, again, I mean, Pitt. You know, the Virginia quarterback had a nice game, not a great game. You know, Pitt contained him fairly well. I mean, the good thing going into this week is that Pitt did just see this type of player last week.
That's true.
You know, so, I mean, there's nothing there that should surprise them as far as the athleticism with this quarterback. They do have a talented backfield. I think the challenge for Pitt's going to be is they have, I think, 3 5-year, 5th-year seniors on the offensive line. They got a good quarterback coming back. They got a deep running back tandem back there. So that's going to be concern. But on the other side of the ball, I mean, you know, Rhode Island, who they beat last week, was able to put up like over 300 yards of offense.
Yeah, I believe they're a 1AA team as well. Exactly. I think so.
So, you know, and Mark Whipple, when he was at UMass, you know, played Ohio and rung up some big yardage, some big points against, you know, Ohio in the past. So, you know, getting back to our early conversation, if the offense doesn't click this week, there's serious concerns.
You would think on an individual basis, Pitt should have a lot of matchups that favor the Panthers.
Right. There should be definitely more talent on that field.
Right. It's just a matter of them executing, if Pickett can put them on them, if the receivers can catch the football, because both are question marks. And on the defensive side, I don't know. I didn't see the film of the Ohio game. I don't know how many of these runs are called runs, because a lot of Virginia's were scrambles. So I don't know if it's kind of more of a, you know, triple option quarterback kind of keep, you know, wildcat type of RPO action, but it's going to take a lot of discipline defensively to stay in your lanes and make the tackle when it presents itself. So, you know, one off the top of my head, it was the long run against Virginia, but Pinnock, free shot at the quarterback, swing and a miss, man. Yep. I mean, at the very little, you got a breakdown, and then there were a couple others where the kids were breaking down, and then because of that, he got the pass off, and it was a jump ball, and it's that fine line of going in and just getting there. And then being under control because, you know, he's athletic enough to make you miss. And again, it's tough to practice. Like, the dummy's not going to roll, or the coach, oh, look at me roll. Like, you can't manipulate that because you're not going to let somebody just stand there and get drilled. I totally understand that. But at the same time, it's plays that have to be made at the Division I level.
Absolutely right. Absolutely right. And the other aspect of this game I want to bring up is the Ohio coach, Frank Solich. Well-respected college football coach. If you recall, prior to Ohio, he was at Nebraska.
Really?
Yeah, he was the coach that went 9-3 and got fired by one Mr. Steve Peterson, the ex-AD at the University of Pittsburgh.
No, so he was just at Nebraska before Ohio.
A few years ago, yes, absolutely. Really? A few years ago. It was 9-3 and was fired. So, but anyway, okay. I mean, solid football coach.
Yeah.
Okay, knows how to put a game plan together. You know, obviously Pat Narduzzi thinks very highly of him. If I remember right, he's an Ohio guy as well.
Yeah.
Or has coaching ties in Ohio. So those two know each other very well. So that's concerning. I mean, the guy knows how to coach. But Miho, I'll be honest with you. If you know, I like Pitt covering this 5.5.
I was saying, make a prediction. What do you got?
I like Pitt 35-24.
Ooh.
Something along those lines. I look for the offense to put up some points this week.
That's the over.
Yeah. I look for Pitt to put up some points. I really do. And I will also add, you know, there's a lot of Pitt fans out there, you know, SOP, and all the locals know what that means, the same old Pitt, right? So everyone's paranoid about, here we go, they're thinking about Bowling Green with Wanstead, and actually Pitt losing to Ohio.
Years ago.
Yeah. And boy, I remember watching that game in a hotel room. But anyway, and there's this paranoia, okay? May I tell people in Western PA and all your yinzers out there to just calm down. Okay.
You're going Aaron Rodgers. Relax.
Yes, exactly.
R-E-L-A-X.
Yes. Pat Narduzzi has not lost to a team that they're supposed to beat.
He came close, but he hasn't.
He came close.
Youngstown
State? Oh, Youngstown State was the closest.
Yeah, that's the one I'm remembering.
Youngstown State was the closest.
You're right, though. He tends to show up in games they're supposed to.
They generally do not lose these games under Pat Narduzzi. You know? So I'm going like something like 35-24.
You're a little more ambitious, I think, offensively. I think it's going to be a little bit lower scoring. I think the 5.5, 6.5 really is now. I'm 27-20. Panthers, you know, something like that. More field goals and touchdowns, I think, in Pitt's future. And then, literally, I think it comes down to turning the football over. Like you said, if Pitt turns the ball over, the way Ohio plays, running the football, controlling the clock, wearing you down. If Pickett comes out, you know, long drive, first, second play, turnover. Long drive, you know, turnover. It could get you know, ugly in Pitt's favor, but I don't anticipate that happening, and you can't. But that's the one way they lose this football game is to turn it over twice and, you know, have another blocked punt or a special teams play or something like that to keep Ohio in it. So run the football, Pat. You're bigger, you're stronger,
and then
should wear them down.
And then take your shots.
Exactly.
Yep,
you know,
exactly
run
right.
the football, run some play action, maybe get Pickett a little more of those like RPOs. As you saw, he was running around in the first game probably a little bit more than you want him to. But you see the athleticism there. So, you know, maybe move the pocket a few more, give him a couple short throws, let him find that rhythm, gain some confidence, and then maybe he won't be happy feet in the pocket.
No, I couldn't agree more, Kevin. And I will say one thing, and I almost want to whisper this.
Oh, you may.
If we lose,
yes,
that's not good.
Not good.
Not good. I mean, now
0-4.
You could be staring at 0-4. Oh, yes, and that's
and
not
a new coach by Halloween.
That's no. I mean, and here's the deal about that though. They'd be 0-4, but 0-1 in the conference.
Yeah, that's wild.
So I mean, there's still a lot of football to be played after that. But still, I mean, you know, keeping these kids
6-4 and 6-1 in the conference
and playing for a conference championship again, right? Against Syracuse, by the way.
Yeah, there you go. Little tidbit.
So yeah, no, this is definitely a must win. I mean, absolutely. Yeah, that's why the Virginia game, it would have been nice to have that, you know, because, you know, you're going to at Penn State. It's going to be a difficult game. Not saying we can't win that one. And then UCF, you know, I'm not sold on UCF yet. We're not really sure what they have yet. They got
solid
some new
week
people.
One.
Yeah, they have some solid new people playing. So, you know, jury's still out on them as well.
I agree.
And it is at Pitt, you know, but it is after Penn State, you know, so you have the letdown game there again.
Yeah, absolutely. Hey,
thank you for those schedule makers, by the way. That reminds me of 2 years ago when you played at Penn State and then you came home and played Oklahoma State, for crying out loud. Are you kidding me?
It's wild.
Right? So, but anyway, so no, getting back to this game, it's a huge game. Big game, and you know Pitt's got to have it, and I think they will have it.
And we think they'll have it, but we're interested to hear what you guys think. Obviously, this one's going to be releasing close to kickoff, so we'd love to hear from you guys next Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. Kind of your thoughts, recaps, reactions, comment on our Instagram page. It's Too Close to Call, the number 2 both times. We actually have a hotline you can dial into as well. That is in the description of the episode. So all you Pitt Panther fans out there who are coming across this in the Pitt Panther Fanatics Facebook group, you guys can comment on there on the links or call in, let us know. We'd love to have this be interactive because, like my old man mentioned, if for some reason things don't go well over the next month, we could have some fun talking about what the hell is going on in Western Pennsylvania.
Absolutely correct. I'm looking forward to getting back in touch with you. And for all you, you know, all of my Western PA friends out there, you know, the Rich Kleins, the Charlie Messianos,
the
Mark Massas, the Spadafores, I know you're all Pitt diehards. I know hopefully you're going to listen to this podcast. Please feel free to call in and give your thoughts, views, and observations.
Let's do it. Anyway, we appreciate you guys listening. We'll talk to you guys next week, wrapping up Ohio and previewing Penn State.
Alikanakanak and hail to Pitt.
Peace.